became flesh and lived among us. Good morning, Deo family, and welcome to our new series called Heaven on Earth. Thank you so much for all of you who just give out of your hearts and keep on giving. You guys are making it possible for us to bring God's kingdom here on earth. If you want to make a difference today and you're watching online, please share the sermon. Or if you're in the auditorium, invite someone with you next week. May Emmanuel, God with us, be a reality for us all.
Awesome. Welcome, church. Welcome to Deo Victoria. It's so great for all of you to join us. We're so excited to be together here in this building to be able to worship together and sing together. So we're going to jump straight into worshiping this morning. So I want to ask you to stand with us, and we're going to lift up the name of Jesus, the name that is above every other name. We're going to lift up his name and worship the great big God that we serve. Amen. Praises rising, eyes are turning to you. We turn to you, and hope is stirring, hearts are yearning for you. We long for you. When we see you, we find strength to face the day. And in your presence, all our fears are washed away, washed away. Hosanna, Hosanna, you are the God who saves us, worthy of all our praises. The day, and in your presence, all our fears are washed away. Washed away. Here we go. Hosanna, Hosanna, you are the God who saves us, worthy of all our praises. Hosanna. Hosanna, come every way among us. We welcome you here, Lord Jesus. Cause when we see you, we find strength to face the day. In your presence, all our fears are washed away. When we see you, we find strength to face the day. And in your presence, all our fears are washed away, washed away. Hosanna, Hosanna, you are the God who saves us, worthy of all our praises. Hosanna, Hosanna, come every way among us. We welcome you here, Lord Jesus. Come every way among us. We welcome you here, Lord Jesus.
Thank you.
You have been so, so good to me. Before I took a breath, you breathed your life in me. You have been so, so kind to me. Fight till I'm found, leaves the 99. Oh, I couldn't earn it, I don't deserve it. Still, you give yourself away. Oh, the overwhelming, never ending, reckless love of God.
Till I'm found, leaves the 99. I couldn't earn it, I don't deserve it. Still, you give yourself away. Oh, the overwhelming, never ending, reckless love of God. Yourself away. Oh, the
your presence come. You are all I need. Nothing is as precious as your presence.
There.
One more time, then sings my soul, then sings my soul, then sings my soul, how great your love is, how great your love is.
God, we thank you for your great love this morning.
Yes.
Your unconditional, unending love. Thank you, Lord, that you have loved us enough that you came to this earth to reconcile us to your heart. How great your love is, O God, that you would think of me, a sinner, unrighteous, guilty before you, and yet lay your life down so that I may live. How great your love is to make open the way that even this morning we can spend this time in your presence. That you are not far from us, but that you have sent your Holy Spirit and that you dwell among us. We love to be in your presence, God. We love to celebrate how great you are. How magnificent you are. There is none like you, name above every name. Be glorified, God. And sings my soul. And sings my soul. This point, we've been very quiet and we've just soaked in the presence of God. But as we were singing this chorus one last time, and we said these words, then sings my soul. How great your love is. I think there's an element of celebration that is needed before we take our seats and we close off this time of worship. And so I want to just ask you for a moment, don't you just want to give him a massive, massive praise Clap your hands, shout whatever it is. Then sings our soul, Lord, how great your love is. Amen. Amen. Thank you, Lord. Thank you so much. You can take your seat.
Good morning, Deo family. Have you guys had an awesome festive season and an awesome New Year's? I hope so. While we were worshiping, I was thinking, you know, as a mom, you go through these moments where when it's dinner time and it's just functional, you know, you've got an half an hour, then they've got to eat, they've got to bath the kids, you've got to get them ready, and it's kind of like do-do-do-do-do. And there's not, it's like this task, there's not necessarily joy in that moment. And then there's other times when it's a Friday evening or a Saturday or even a Sunday lunch or special times together. And it's just this joy to serve. And it's just this joy, you know, you've got the kids on the table chopping up veggies and, you know, you've got the fire outside going. And it's a totally different moment. Same thing, it's making food for your family, but it's a different moment. And I want to challenge you today, Day of Family. You're with family today. It's a cherished moment. It's not something you've got to tick off. Okay, I went to church today. Cherish the moment. Take it in. Okay, are we going to take it in? Are we going to cherish it? Praise God. Okay. So if you're here for the first time today, we also want to say we cherish you. You are part of our family in Christ, and we just want to give you a small gift. So if I can ask you a favor, can you maybe just wave a bit for us or something? We just want to give you a little gift. I think there's people there in the front at that side, and there's a whole row. Awesome. Let's give them a round of applause, guys. Afterwards, you're very welcome to join us for coffee. We've got a designated new visitors area, so please join us for a special cup of coffee afterwards. Then just a few announcements from my side. So usually I know when it's the beginning of the month, we do have our first Sunday worship. This week, we will not have first Sunday worship yet, but the offices are opening up tomorrow, the 3rd of January, and then we are in full gear for the new year. So then everything is going to start off. So tonight, have a rest, enjoy that braai with your family, but from the 3rd of January, we're going to kick off with all of our wonderful activities bit by bit. So just keep an eye out on our media, on our SMSs, on our emails, and you'll be up to date for everything that's going on here at church. Then I want to share a special scripture with you guys. And I truly feel like this is the scripture that God gave to me for this year. You're welcome to open up your Bible apps or to open up the Word of God. It's Isaiah 52, verse 7. It says, "How beautiful upon the mountains are the feet of him who bring good tidings, who publishes peace, who brings good tidings of good, who publishes salvation, who says to Zion, your God reigns." May we all have beautiful feet this year. May we all spread the gospel in whichever way we can. And on that note, I really want to thank all of you that have been giving so continuously and so generously and sowing into this ministry at Deo Victoria, enabling us to have beautiful feet and to have beautiful hands and to make a difference. So today we're also going to sow into this ministry, but with a heart of wanting to have beautiful hands and feet, and with a heart of wanting to keep on to just spread the wonderful good news and the wonderful love of Christ. So you can prepare your tithes and offerings, and then I will just do a prayer for us. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for the opportunity to have beautiful hands and beautiful feet in your kingdom. Thank you for calling us to make a difference. Thank you that we can also give back what you have given to us in order to sow into the lives of others. We praise your wonderful name. We love you, Jesus, and we want to continue to do whatever you call us to do and to make a difference where you show us to make a difference. And we all say, amen. Those that will help with the tithes and offerings, you're welcome to take it up. We're going to listen to some wonderful music. Then I have the great privilege to hand over the mic and the chance to share on this stage to JP LaRue. And if you're at home, if you're watching online, he's also our youth pastor. So if you've got some young ones at home, call them. They must come and listen. They're really going to enjoy it. And I think all of us are just really so excited to hear what God placed on this young man's heart. You're our brother. We appreciate you. And we're so excited to listen to you. Thank you, JP.
Awesome. Thanks, Marissa. Good morning, Deo family. I'm going to move this table a little bit forward. And the reason is because I feel like I'm at the back of the stage. And I don't want to be that far away from you. Yeah, it's a privilege for me this morning. Once again, this thing is flickering. So I'm just saying this thing will run out of battery power, but that's fine. We'll deal with it when we get to it. Morning, Deo family. It's such a privilege for me once again to be here, to share the word of God with you. But allow me, first of all, to say this. Happy New Year. we are in 2022, and I hope that this year is the best year for you so far. Let's close our eyes and just pray together. Father God, I just want to thank you, Lord, as I always do. First of all, Lord, that we can come together here. Thank you, Lord, for a brand new year. But Father God, also for a brand new day, Lord, like this, where we can come together and worship you. Father God, as a family, as your church, as a body. And Lord, I thank you. And I pray, Lord, that you be with us, Father God, that the words that I speak, Lord, come from your heart. Father God, I pray that you be here, Lord, and just work in the way that only you can work. And I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Oh, thanks, John. If you complain about technical stuff, John is always like, I'm going to fix it now. I want to start off with a story about my school career. When I was in school, I come from a small town called Marble Hall. Now, you don't need to worry about where Marble Hall is or what Marble Hall is or how it is. It's a small town in Limpopo. That's where I went to school. When I was in school, I was a rugby player. I loved rugby. Rugby was in my blood. Not so much these days, but when I was in school, I was a rugby player. And I was... I'm not too sure what the English is, but I was in the back line. I don't know if that's the correct use. I was in the back line. I was number 10, 11. I was both wings. I was inside center, outside center. Number 10, the one who kicks the ball. I was him. And I was even number 15, fullback for a time. And that was the positions that I played. But I always wanted to be in the front. Where the action is, you know, in the scrums, there where it's face-to-face. Because I don't know if you know this, but if you play number 15, the majority of the game is you standing and waiting and looking where the action is and maybe going a little bit forward and looking at the birds in the sky. Oh, tying your shoelaces. That's that's what the positions I played. But I always wanted to be in the scrums. I wanted to be the front row. I don't know what it's called in English. I apologize. I am not English. I am Afrikaans. But I wanted to be where the action is. We had a subject in school called life orientation, LO. I don't know if you are familiar with this subject, life orientation. I still don't know exactly what it is, but I know that I passed it, so. And as a part of life orientation, once every term, we were required to do a physical, practical period. And this was probably the government's way of ensuring that we jogged every once in a while, so that we just could stay active at least. And for this one period, the practical period that we had this term, we decided, our class, we are going to have a rugby tournament. And I, as always, was in the back row, and it was a good time, it was a fun time. But then I decided, I'm just going to try out being in the front for a while. I'm going to try and be in the front row where the action, I'm going to be in the scrums, I'm going to be face to face, that's where I'm going to be. And I did it, and I had fun, but I was a backline player. That was my position. Practice, that is what I practiced to do. That was, when I receive the ball, I play like a backline player. I play like an inside center or an outside center or a left wing or a right wing. I played all these positions, not at the same time. I know it's a small town, but we at least had 15 players in our team. But my game was completely off in this one rugby match that we had, because I was in the scrum, and this is not where I'm supposed to be. This is not my space. And I remember there was a moment where I caught the ball, and my inside center skills kicked in, and I started to play like an inside center or an outside center, and I ran like a backline player. And I was completely caught off guard when someone tackled me from behind, and I didn't see it coming. And I don't know if you know this, but if you play rugby and you get tackled, you need to fall a certain way. You need to fall the correct way as to not get hurt, or you need to throw the ball backwards and all these sorts of things. But I was caught off guard. I did not see this tackle coming. And because I was caught off guard, I fell, and I fell wrong. And I'm not going to go into too much gruesome detail, but when I fell with my body weight and the body weight of the person tackling me on this left wrist of mine. And you can just imagine a toothpick being snapped. That's exactly how it is. Now, I'm, like I said, not going to go into too much detail, but I can say this in all honesty, it's not a pleasant experience. It was sore. And I actually have scars of the surgery that I had to receive. I got some metal pins in, and anyway. The point of the story is this. In this one moment, my rugby career was over completely. I played cricket onwards, but it was never the same. It was never the same again. My rugby career was over. And in one moment, my life completely changed. And we all have stories like this, where one moment in our lives changes the course of our lives completely. Now, this is an example of how things change for the worse. But there are examples of moments where our lives change for the better as well. Let me give you an example, if I can paint you a scenario. Imagine for a moment that at the end of a long work day, and this is one of those days where everyone is making mistakes and you have to fix everything and you are running around, and it's the end of this work day, and it was just one of those days. You get into your car and you drive home, and while you drive home, I always say that there are a lot of special people on the road, and you encounter some of these special people on the road while you go home, and you get home and you just want a cup of coffee. That's all you want. this is going to change this day. And you go and you switch on the kettle and the kettle starts boiling. And you open the cupboard and then you realize you have forgotten to buy milk. And there's no milk for your coffee. And you think to yourself, well, this day cannot get any worse. And then you get a notification on your cell phone. And it's an SMS. And I don't know much about SMSs, but you read it and it says that your salary is in. You've received your salary. And all of a sudden, the bad day that you've had doesn't matter anymore. Because you've got your salary and now you're planning on going to the shops and buying milk, first of all, for your coffee. And you're buying this and this and this. And all of a sudden, that moment changes, at least for a moment, your life. If I can use a better example, I'll say this. For those of you who have children, I don't need to remind you of that one moment when you found out that there was a little one on the way. When you found out that you were pregnant. That moment when you found out changed your life completely, forever. Your life was never going to be the same again. In that one moment, it changes completely. And this is so relatable. I think we all have stories of one moments that changes our lives. Maybe for the better, maybe for the worse. But I know that many of you might be sitting here in desperation, looking for one of these moments. One of these moments where you are saying, I just want this life-changing moment where things just turn around. Because I know that there might be some of you, and I'm not going to say that. I'm not going to say there might be some of you. I know that there are some of you sitting here with problems in your lives. And it feels like your life is just falling apart. It just feels like your life is not working out. Now, there might be problems at home. There might be problems in your relationships. There might be problems at your job, at your work. There might be problems financially. There might be problems with your health, even with your physical health or your emotional health or whatever the case may be. But I know that we all face pains and problems where we come to a place where we pray, and when we pray to God, we say, I just need one moment. One moment where this changes. And when we speak about heaven on earth, we are speaking of these moments where heaven meets earth and your life changes radically. And the trajectory of your life, I wanted to use a big word there, I'm not going to try that again, but where your life changes course for the better. And I know that some of you might be sitting here with a problem that you've been walking around with for weeks, maybe months, or maybe even years. And I know the longer these problems persist, it seems to be hopeless. It seems to be, in Afrikaans, we call it, this one's lot in eleven. This is just what we need to deal with. But I wanted to talk this morning about these heaven on earth moments where things change, where heaven meets earth, and all of a sudden, things just completely change. And the question is, how do we experience these moments? How do we experience these heaven on earth moments? There's one moment there where my life is falling apart, and then all of a sudden, there's a change, and things are looking up again in life. How do we get these moments? How do we find these moments? I believe that the answer obviously lies in Scripture. The answer lies in Scripture, and I believe that the answer lies in a very famous Bible story, a popular Bible story that I'm going to read in a moment. But I know that when we read these famous Bible stories or these popular Bible stories, what tends to happen is we tend to read, and then we get to the story and we say, oh, we know the story. I know the story, and you just read over it without putting much thought into it, without thinking too much about it, and you just read over it and you go on. But I believe that we should just, for a moment, stand still at this Bible story. Because I believe that there's something in this Bible passage that holds the answer to this question as to how do I receive this heaven on earth? How do I get these moments, these life-changing moments? Now, the story is found in the book of Mark, and you are more than welcome to open your Bibles to the book of Mark, chapter 5, from verse 24. Now, verse 24 is just a little bit of context. I'm a picture person. I like painting pictures, and I like seeing pictures. And this verse paints this picture pretty well for me. Verse 24, Mark 5, verse 24 says, "And a great crowd followed him and thronged about him." And I want you to imagine this scenario for just a moment. This is talking about Jesus. Jesus is walking through this town, and the people of the town is just flocking him and is just surrounding him. And they are pushing and stomping and stooting everywhere around him and wrestling to get to Jesus. And I can imagine why. I can imagine why. I mean, imagine for a moment you are in their shoes. You hear of this man, Jesus. And you hear whenever he comes to town, all of a sudden the blind starts seeing. All of a sudden the deaf starts hearing. The lame starts walking. You hear this man is coming to your town. I think to myself that, well, I just know this, that they wanted to hear what this man has to say. Because if there's anyone that I need to listen to, it's the man that lets the blind see and lets the deaf hear. But then the story begins in verse 25. It says, "And there was a woman who had had a discharge of blood for 12 years." And now the story kicks off with this woman, and the Bible refers specifically to this woman who has a medical condition. She has a medical condition that she's been suffering with for 12 years. For 12 years, she's been walking around with this specific medical issue. And just to put it into perspective, that is 4,380 days that she's been walking around suffering with this medical issue. And I know for a lot of you sitting here this morning, this relates personally. I know for a lot of you, the problems in your life have been persisting for years. The story goes on, however, in verse 26. It says, "And who had suffered much under many physicians and had spent all that she had and was no better, but rather grew worse." You see this woman's desperation in this verse, in this one verse. She sells everything that she has. Everything. Her last rand and cent she spends trying to solve this problem that she was walking with, that she was living with. And for 12 years, she was urgently looking for this one moment that could change her life. And I know for a lot of you have spent a lot of time and maybe even a lot of money in desperation looking for solutions to the problems that you might be facing, to these problems that have been persistent for a long time. Now, the woman even goes to numerous doctors, to physicians, for help. She goes to them for help, but the Bible says that they just cannot help her. And look, I think doctors are wonderful people. Obviously, they are much smarter than me. But I know that for some of you sitting here knows this feeling. When you go to the doctors and you sit there with a physical health or a problem that you are dealing with, and the doctor is looking you in the eye and says, "I'm sorry, I can't help you with this." I know some of you might know this feeling very well. Some of you might have experienced this yourselves, but your heart sinks into your chest. You are crushed emotionally. And I think this woman for 12 years must have felt this exact same feeling. Emotionally crushed. Now, I can only imagine, but I know that many of you don't have to imagine. I know many of you are experiencing this. But the story does go on. In verse 27, it says, she had heard the reports about Jesus and came up behind him in the crowd and touched his garments. Verse 28, for she said, if I touch even his garments, I will be made well. Now, again, I'm a picture person. I like painting pictures because it just helps me understand the situation. I want you to imagine this. This woman, because of her condition under Jewish law, means she is unclean. And so she has to live apart from all the other people. She's living outside of the town. But now she hears about this man. She hears about Jesus. She hears the reports, the miracles that happen when he goes from town to town. She hears about the blind seeing. She hears about the deaf hearing, the lame walking. These heaven on earth moments. And now, this Jesus, this man, is coming to her town. And I can just imagine her excitement, saying, today is the day when I might be healed. Today is the day where I might be healed. And she wakes up early in the morning, and I'm going to paint a little bit of a picture. This is not exactly what happened, but just bear with me. I can just imagine her waking up, putting on her makeup, putting on her best shoes, putting on her best dress, getting ready to go. And she walks to this town, and as she's walking, every step that she's taking, she's getting more and more excited because she's going to meet Jesus. And this Jesus is the one who heals people. This is the reports that she heard, and she's walking to town, and she's walking, and as she's walking, excitement is growing, and excitement is growing. And then she walks into town, and she sees this great crowd of people. And she can't even see Jesus. And this great crowd of people is there. Now, you can imagine, it looks like the queue at Home Affairs, for instance. It's just people. It's chaos. People pushing, stomping. There's no social distancing. No one is wearing a mask. And now she sees these people. But she's determined. She says, no, I'm not going to turn away now. I've come this far. Today is the day when I meet Jesus. And she starts walking through these people. She starts walking through these people. I can just imagine her getting and looking for Jesus, looking to get to Jesus. And she's wrestling against this great crowd of people just to get to Jesus because this Jesus is going to heal her. And she thinks to herself, if I can only touch his garments, I don't even need to speak to him. I don't even need to let him put his hands on me or anything like that. No, I just need to touch his cloak, his clothes, and I will be healed. And she pushes through, and she pushes through, and she pushes through, and finally, she gets to Jesus. She touches his garments. And the next verse says, and immediately, the flow of blood dried up, and she felt in her body that she was healed of her disease. For 12 years, she's been walking around with this disease. For 12 years, she's been walking around with this problem. She touches just the piece of fabric that Jesus is wearing. And immediately, she is healed. And when she touched Jesus, Jesus' reaction, and the next two verses are very interesting for me. Very interesting for me, and I'll tell you why in a moment. So verse 30 says, and Jesus, perceiving in himself that power had gone out from him, immediately turned about in the crowd and said, who touched my garments? And the disciple said in verse 31, said to him, you see the crowd pressing around you, and yet you say, who touched me? Now this is a very interesting verse for me. This is interesting because the woman wasn't the only person there. There were a lot of people. were a lot of people to the point where when Jesus asked, who touched me? The disciples thought it was a weird question. Because everyone is touching you, Jesus. Everyone. Look at these people. They are pressing up against you. Everyone is touching you. What are you asking? But it was only when she touched him, when power went through him, when power went out of him. And we read that she was the only one who got healed. Now, probably, she wasn't the only one with problems there. I can imagine that there were a lot of people with problems. We read about a lot of blind people in the Bible. I'm sure there was some blind people there. I'm sure there was some deaf people there who couldn't hear, lame people who couldn't walk. I'm sure there were people there with problems. And they also heard the rumors and they also heard the reports of Jesus and they wanted to see this man for themselves. And they went there, but yet the Bible only speaks about this one woman who got healed. They touched him as well. Why didn't they get healed? Why do we only read about this one woman? This one woman who's been walking around for 12 years with a medical problem, who touched only his cloak, only the fabric, she got healed. My question is, what makes her so different from the other people that she is healed when she touches him and they do not? I believe the answer is simple. If you read this scripture, there's one verse that I believe the answer is in. And it's the verse that said, she thought to herself, if I could just touch his garments, I would be healed. I believe the answer is in her thoughts. I believe her thoughts were different from the other people. And this is what I wanted to talk to you about this morning. And the punchline of my sermon is, you are one thought away from heaven on earth. You are one thought away from that one moment that will change your life forever. Now this woman, she thought, if I could only touch his garments, then I would be healed. That was her thought. When I look at this thought that she had, a few things jump out for me. A few things struck me as I read this story. The first thing that struck me was she had a positive expectation. Now, the reason why I say positive expectation and not just an expectation is because the truth is we all have expectations. We all have expectations about everything. I mean, when you woke up this morning, you had an expectation of church. You came here expecting that there was going to be a sermon. You came here expecting that we were going to sing some songs and we're going to pray. And when you walked in and you saw the communion tables, you were expecting, okay, sometime during this service, we are going to partake in communion. And we are going to partake in communion. But the point is, we all have expectations. The question, however, is, do we have positive expectations or negative expectations? That is the question. And that is what we need to determine for ourselves. I think that the differences between the positive... Okay, that's, I just said that. So let me ask you this. Do you come to church with a positive or negative expectation? Do you come to church expecting to meet the God of the universe? Do you come to church expecting to worship the God of the universe with family, in truth and in spirit? Or, as I sometimes do you come to church expecting that one auntie is going to be here and I just don't want to talk to her? Or do you expect that the band is going to sing that song and I don't like that song? What is your expectation when you come to church? The woman in the story had a positive expectation. She thought to herself, if I can touch his garment, I would be healed. She didn't think to herself, if I could only touch his garment, maybe I'll be healed. If I can only touch his, there's a chance that I would be healed, 50-50, I don't know. No. Her thought was she will be healed. There was an absolute conviction in her to say that if I touch his garment, I will be healed. Now, what expectations do you have when you drive to work on a Monday morning, for instance? What are your expectations for the day? What are your expectations when you go home from a Monday, when you leave work on a Monday afternoon? When you pray to God, what are your expectations? Do you expect God to work, or do you expect to talk to the air, as some might say? David was a man of prayer, but he was also a man full of positive expectations. And when I read what he wrote in the Psalms, in Psalm 5 verse 3, it says the following. It says, O Lord, in the morning you might hear my voice. No, that's not what it says. It says, O Lord, in the morning you will hear my voice. In the morning, I prepare a sacrifice for you and watch. Eagerly awaiting, what is the Lord going to do? Because he had a positive expectation that the Lord was going to work. Now, let me ask you this question just for a moment. If you agree with me, put up your hand. Who agrees with me that we are children of God? That we are children of God. So my question to you is this. If we are children of God, why do our expectation or our expectations not look like children's expectations? Sometimes we don't expect something positive. We've got these negative expectations. And the truth is, if we walk around with these negative expectations, how can we expect change? If this woman saw the crowd of people, turned around and ran away, if this woman had negative expectations, I don't think she would have bothered to even try and touch the garments of Jesus. Because what's the point? Nothing's going to happen. But she had positive expectations, and it's because of these positive expectations that she pressed through. She touched the garments of Jesus, and she was healed at the end of the day. The second thing that I noticed in the thought of this woman is she was determined to be healed. She was determined to be healed. And this just jumps out from the scriptures for me. Now, let me ask you this. How determined are you to be healed of your problems? The moment I ask this question, it's like, well, JP, of course. Of course I'm determined to be healed of my problems. What? It sounds like a stupid question. But I know how it goes, and I'm guilty of this. I know how it goes. When Saturday nights become a long night, you have a braai with your friends, or you go to the dam, you do some fishing, or whatever it is, I am not that determined to go to church the next day. And even if I do, I know that when I sit in church on a Sunday, I'm not that determined to listen to Pastor Harry's sermon always. And I just drift off. And sometimes when... Well, let me ask you this. Have you ever prayed to God and asked God, Lord, I need someone to just pray for me. That is all I need. And then you come to church, and at the end of the service, the pastor gives an invitation. It says, if you need prayer, come to the front. And then you're not that determined anymore. You're like, I don't know if I should do this. I know I am first in line, and I'm guilty of this as well. And I think that we need to reevaluate and say, how determined are we really for our healing? And again, my heart is not to step on any toes or pass judgment or anything, but my heart is really just to ask, how determined are we? The woman saw the crowd of people and she said, I'm going to touch the garments of Jesus. She saw the crowd of people. She didn't turn around and walked away. No, she forced herself through these people. She forced herself. She wrestled and stomped and stood and did what she could. With everything in her, she did what she could to get to the garments of Jesus. Now, if she hadn't been this determined, she would have saw the crowd of people and say, maybe another day. Maybe if I come a little bit earlier, I'll be first in queue or something. And then she walked away. But that's not what she did. She was determined to get to Jesus because, well, before I'm getting ahead of myself, but let me just say this. We know this verse in Matthew 6. Matthew 6 verse 33 says this. But seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be added to you. In other words, before you do anything, before you do anything, make sure that you seek the kingdom of God first. Make sure that you are determined to get to the feet of Jesus before anything else. Because here's the thing, I believe, and I believe that you believe with me, but I believe that our healing lies at the feet of Jesus. Amen? Now, if I believe that my healing is there at the feet of Jesus, then I am going to do everything in my power to get there. And here's the thing, the world's not going to stop me. The crowds of people are not going to stop me. Nothing is going to stop me because I'm determined to get there because that's where my healing is. And that's where I'm going to be. And I'm going to fight and claw if I have to get there. Not physically fight or anything like that, but as a figure of speech. How determined are we? Because maybe it is that your healing lies in worship in truth and in spirit. Maybe it is that your answer lies in the sermon on Sunday or in the prayer invitation after the service. And maybe we should just become a little bit more dedicated and determined to really seek Jesus in our problems. The last thing that I see in this thought of this woman is she believed that healing was there for her too. That healing was there for her as well. Now, the woman saw this crowd of people, and now this crowd of people, I've repeated myself a lot of times, there were a lot of people there. But she saw the crowd of people. She saw the people with problems. She saw that there were people there for healing as well. But she said, so am I. So am I. I am also going to be healed today. She believed that healing was there for her too. Many times we think, you know, God will solve other people's problems. And we say it with conviction. And we believe it with conviction. I mean, how easy is it? Think to yourself. How many times have you prayed for someone? How many times have you spoken to someone where it was so easy for you to believe that God was going to heal that person and you believe it with complete conviction? But when it comes to my problems, I don't know. Eh? My problems don't seem that big. I don't think God really has time for my problems. All of a sudden, it becomes so hard. It becomes difficult to believe that healing is there for you as well. Because we keep comparing ourselves to other people. We keep comparing our problems with other people's problems. And we say, yeah, God's gonna heal you. But I don't know. I don't know if he's going to heal me. And sometimes I think that we believe this because we don't always understand the love that God has for us. Now, I'll be honest. I do not understand the love of God. It is a mystery to me. I don't understand how a holy and pure God can love a sinner like me. It does not make sense. But I know that it's true. I know that it's true because of what the following verse says in Romans 8. I'm just going to read the last part of the verse. It says this. It says in Romans 8 verse 15, you have received the spirit of adoption as sons by whom we cry, Abba, Father. And now this word, Abba, is such an interesting word. I listened to a podcast. This isn't in my notes. That's why I have to think about it. But I listened to a podcast this week by a man called Dr. Michael Brown. And he didn't speak about this, but he touched on it. And he said this. He said the word Abba is the most intimate word for father. And that is the truth. And the Jewish children, even till this day, call their fathers Abba. Their earthly fathers, they call them Abba. And if I can give an English equivalent to this word, Abba, it's like calling your father daddy. It's like daddy. And when a young child calls out to daddy, daddy is there. And he's there to help. And yes, I know that God is our king. God is the God of the universe who created everything. He is the King of Kings. He is the Lord of Lords. And we submit to him. But the Bible also calls him our Heavenly Father. Now, here's my question. When a child, for instance, falls and scrapes his knee, and he runs to his daddy and he says, "Daddy, help me." And he's crying because he's hurting. What good earthly father would go, "Ach man, that's a small cut. There are children with bigger problems in the world. Go away, you are wasting my time." No. A good father will pick up his child and put a pleisterkie on, give it a little kiss, drive to go get some ice cream. Really nurture the child, comfort the child. And that is who our Heavenly Father is. We know we can have confidence in the fact that when we go to him with our problems, that he hears us. When we go to him with our problems, he listens. He is, and this is what I want you to realize, he is a God of love. He is a God of love. And his love, like I say, is a mystery to me. But he's there. And he won't turn his back on you when it comes to your problems. And that's what I want you to know this morning, is he is our Heavenly Father. And I want you to believe that. Because it's such a beautiful thing. It's such a beautiful thing. Now, right before we partake in communion, I just want to say this. I know this is a well-known Bible story, and I know that there probably are a lot better sermons than this sermon about this Bible story, and that there are models of counseling and all these sorts of things written, and this Bible story really brings comfort to people. But I want to remind you that this is a true story. I want to remind you that this is a true story. There really was a woman who's been suffering for 12 years. And the moment she met Jesus, the moment she touched the garments of Jesus, she was healed. The moment when heaven met earth for her, her life was changed. And in that one moment, and I want to remind you, you are one thought away from heaven on earth. You are one thought away from this one moment. Now, I want to ask you for a moment just to close your eyes. And I want you to think about the reality of the problems and the pains that you are facing. Because it's there, it's real, it's not made up or anything. I want you to think about the pain that you've been feeling. Because this morning, I want to introduce you to Jesus Christ. This morning, I want to introduce you to the one who made the blind see. I want to introduce you to the one that made the deaf hear, that made the lame walk. I want to introduce you to the one who died on the cross in your place so that you can stand before God blameless. I want to introduce you to the one who dynamically and powerfully rose from the dead for your justification. That is the person, the man, Emmanuel, God, with us, that I want to introduce to you this morning. And I want to say this, and I want to encourage you. In a moment, I'm going to invite you to the communion tables to take come to the communion tables. But I want to encourage you, because you've got a chance this morning. You've got a chance this morning to approach Jesus Christ. You've got a chance this morning. And I want to encourage you, when you partake in this beautiful thing, communion. I believe when Jesus said, "Take this bread as my body and eat, this wine, my blood, drink," he spoke about our forgiveness, he spoke about our restoration, but I also believe that our healing lies in the blood of Jesus Christ. And when I invite you this morning to the communion table, I want to encourage you, come with positive expectations that Jesus is going to do something wonderful in your life this morning. I want to encourage you, when you approach the communion table, to know that this healing is for you as well. And because of that, I want you to become determined, even for a moment, to meet Jesus Christ. Let's close our eyes and pray just for a moment. Jesus, I want to thank you, Lord, for your sacrifice that you made on the cross 2,000 years ago. Lord, I want to thank you for the blood that you have poured out, for your body that was broken. And the fact that we can feel the effects of it 2,000 years later testifies to the power of that. And Lord, I pray this morning that you meet with us. That you meet with us in the pain and in the sufferings and in the problems and the situations of life that we find ourselves in. Lord, when we partake of this communion table, let us be reminded of your great love for us, of your absolute magnificence, of your grace, of your power. And Lord, I pray that we meet with you this morning. In Jesus' name, amen. You are more than welcome to move to the communion tables in the corners of the church. And I want to ask that for those of you who might find it a little bit difficult to move around, that we serve each other as well, because we are the body of Christ, we are the church, and that is what we do. You are more than welcome to move to the communion tables. thank you, Abba Father, that we can call you Abba Father. That we can call you our heavenly Father. Not a distant Father, not an evil Father or anything like that, but a heavenly Father who draws close to his children in times of need. Let us always be reminded, Lord, of who you are. Let us always be reminded, Lord, of your great love for us. And Lord, may we find comfort in that. Lord, as we go our separate ways this week, wherever we might find ourselves, I pray that your Spirit might just lead us. Lord, to show us the moments where heaven meets earth, so we can celebrate in that. So we can worship you for that. We love you, Abba Father. In Jesus' name. Amen. Dear family, thank you so much for being here this morning. I want to invite you all for a cup of coffee at the back there. But wherever you might find yourself this week, I pray that you will experience heaven on earth. Thank you.